integration.
Carpets, home of the next day install studios on the Fan.
I close my
gone. Couple 13, 14 pass here on the Common Man program. I'm Common. He's 10 and B. We welcome longtime Fish Wrap Factory West Side hockey writer, now works for The Athletic. It's Michael Russo on the Connecticut Water Systems Hotline. Even though you're not on the Connecticut Water Systems Hotline, I think you're either on the Opal, the Emerald, or the Sapphire, we call it. It's a broadcast mechanism we use. Which one of those three are you on? Do you know?
I'm actually on the OnSip.
OnSip?
I don't know what the OnSip. Yeah, OnSip. Oh. O-N-S-I-P is what I'm on. That's what the big boss program director tells me to use now, so I always go on that.
Well, wonders never cease. It almost sounds like you're in a tin can, but it's really it doesn't sound bad.
I think this might be my I was talking to Brandon during the break. This might be my Common debut.
Is this the first time you've been on with Common?
Really? Yeah, I think so. I mean, only when you're hosting, other than like maybe when I'm filling in for Barrero and you come in like 10 minutes before and shoot the breeze a bit.
You're right.
But I feel like, I don't think I've been on with you before.
Well, here's what I'll say.
In fact, until today, you didn't know that I left the strip.
No, as a matter of fact, I'm still trying to figure out what The Athletic is. how can people, let's get that out of the way right away. Cause I have you on and I feel like, I mean, that's where your main bait. I don't even know if they pay you for this, but I know they pay you for, at The Athletic, you can subscribe to it, right. And get all sorts of, not just Minnesota sports, but that thing is filled with sports stories from all across the country and the world. Correct.
Yeah, no, we've got, it's 650 employees now. Wow. It's crazy. In everywhere from England to the United States, Canada, obviously, Australia, it's definitely been a heck of a ride, just to get to this point 4 years in. And yeah, anybody can subscribe at any point, just by going to theathletic.com.
Yeah. Athletic.com. Well, it's unfortunate that your Common Man debut is under the circumstances of the death of, Tom Kurvers. And, you know, as I just talked about in the last segment before we went to break and brought you on, I was introduced to him by Tennessee. I don't know if it was two or we didn't have a state fair last year, so I think it might have been the previous two state fairs where the very first one, Tennessee said, hey, how would you like to have Tom Kurvers on with the Wild? He loves golf. And I go, let's bring him on. And I asked him golf questions. Tennessee asked him hockey questions. And he was kind and is generous with his time, and he had a great sense of humor, and he got the bit about me asking the golf questions, and he was very upfront about his battle with cancer. And as Tennessee and I talked about, he fought it very courageously and acted almost like if it was an inconvenience to other people rather than himself.
Yeah, it really is amazing. I mean, anytime I texted to just check up on him, he would do everything possible to basically let you know that he was doing well and fighting and all that stuff. And you always had to, really get updates from his friends and other people around, people with the team. And he really fought it courageously, valiantly, respectfully throughout this. And I remember when I first sat down with him 2.5 years ago, I sat down with him just days after he was diagnosed, and he was still coming to grips with it. And a couple days later, as word started to get out, we saw him in the press box and scouts coming up to him and tears flowing. And that's, I think, when I started to realize just how absolute serious this was. And, it's just such a sad day. 58 years old, 4 children, 2 adult children in their young 20s, but 2 young teenagers as well. And this is just you know, he's got so many friends in the hockey world, just seeing the tributes, you know, flowing in today and text messages that I've gotten from people around the league, the Ray Ferraros. And he was just an unbelievable human being and obviously a legend in Minnesota.
Well, and I didn't really, I mean, I knew he was a successful hockey player and broadcaster and he was in the front office. I didn't really realize it still till I started reading today all the different pieces about Tom and how, I mean, a Hobey Baker Award winner, WCHA Player of the Year, All-American. He captained the Bulldogs to the 84 NCAA championship game, went on and had a very successful National Hockey League career with, what, you know, 6-7 different teams, and then broadcasting and front office work. He must have been a hell of a player.
Yeah, he absolutely was. And as you mentioned, I mean, you know, his senior year that he captained UMD, they lost in 4 overtimes in the national championship game. He very easily could have won that. And I remember I was talking to Tom one day about that year, and he was having this great, great season. And his roommate, Norm McIver at the time, actually looks at him one day and goes, you know, you're going to win this Hobey Baker Award. And it was like the first time that it ever even dawned on him that he would have a chance for it. And then he goes and wins the Hobey Baker, and he goes on and has just a great, great career. Actually won a cup with the Canadians in 1986, but he was hurt throughout it. But the other thing about him is that he was always in sort of the crossfire of history. You know, in 1989, he was traded to the Toronto Maple Leafs. He had a great year with the Devils, was traded to the Maple Leafs because the Iron Curtain came down and Lou Lamoriello got Slava Fetisov to defect from the Soviet Union, come over and left shot power play defenseman. So Tom lost his job. He's traded to the Maple Leafs for a first round pick 2 years later. That first-round pick wound up being Scott Niedermeyer. And so he lost his job because of Slava Fetisov, a Hall of Famer. That pick wound up being Scott Niedermeyer, a Hall of Famer. And he used to joke that he was sort of the Fetisov, Niedermeyer sandwich. And forever in Toronto, they always pointed out that Tom Kurvers was traded for Scott Niedermeyer. And he used to love it. I mean, you know, it wasn't his fault. And he used to, you know, handle it with a laugh. Another really good story is that one of the most famous nights in NHL history was when Mario Lemieux scored a goal in all 5 ways that you could possibly do it, even strength, shorthanded, power play, empty net goal, and penalty shot. Well, at the buzzer, Tom Kurvers is chasing him down. You can see it on YouTube. Tom Kurvers to this day will tell you that green light went on and that empty net goal didn't go in, and the game ended 7-6. Well, the next day he's looking in the box score and he sees that the game ended 8-6, and they just handed him the goal that he thought that he stopped Mario doing. And if he had stopped that goal, it would have been the end of history right there. But you know, to this day though, Tommy will say that goal should not have counted.
We're talking with Michael Russo, The Athletic, talking about the life and times of Tom Kurvers, who died of lung cancer the other day. I saw in one of the pieces I was reading that, you know, again, like a lot of people do, he credits his mom and dad with his success. His dad was a 3 or 4 star athlete at Hopkins and won basketball tournaments. And I didn't realize this, and how sad was this, that his mother also had cancer and died a couple of years before him.
Yeah, he was diagnosed a year after she died, and it was a really painful death. And, man, it still breaks me up, Tom, talking to me about how he was once visiting down in Arizona where his mom and dad lived and with his daughters, and how, his dad came down and said, sorry, you know, his mom can't come down, that she just can't catch a break. And I just remember how tough that was for Tommy. But his dad, Jim, who plays something like 150 rounds of golf a year, so you'd absolutely love him.
Yeah.
Common. He won 2 state championships at Hopkins. He played football at North Dakota State. He was a baseball star at Hopkins. Tom Kurvers, was a 3-sport athlete at Jefferson. And, you know, he was just, it's hard to talk about because, you know, one of the greatest experiences that I had with Tom was at the 2018 playoffs when he was pre-scouting the Winnipeg Jets for the Tampa Bay Lightning in case the Tampa Bay Lightning played them in the Stanley Cup final. So he spent a week and a half in Winnipeg, and at the time the Athletic didn't have a Vegas Golden Knights writer, so I was covering the Vegas Winnipeg series up there. So I got to spend basically a week and a half with Tom, with Dean Grillo, another good friend of his who's a current agent in the game, and they used to golf every single day, but we spent 3-4 hours every single morning in the concierge lounge at the Delta Hotel in Winnipeg, just talking hockey, talking life, and who knew that a month later, Tom Kurvers would be leaving the Lightning and becoming Paul Fenton's right-hand man with the Minnesota Wild. You know, he didn't even know at the time. This was before Paul Fenton was actually hired as the GM. And, you know, next thing you know, about 5-6 weeks later, Tom joins the Wild. He actually was with the Lightning. He didn't sit at their table on the draft floor, which gave us all indications that potentially he was coming to Minnesota. And eventually he did a couple days later. And it was just it was a dream come true for him. And then just as fate has it, 7 months later, he's diagnosed with this just awful sentence.
You know, the hockey world as good as anybody inside and outside. As an assistant general manager, what kind of responsibility? I mean, you're the assistant, you're the general manager, but you're an assistant. What are the responsibilities there? And is it, you know, do you get a lot of the credit? You're doing most of the grunt work, or how instrumental was he in working with the Wild all those years?
Yeah, well, unfortunately, because he was diagnosed so soon after getting the job, he really did have to take a step back the last 2 or 3 years. But he did run the Iowa Wild. But when Paul Fenton first took over, you know, he inherited Chuck Fletcher's front office. And so Tom Kurvers wasn't just his right-hand man. He was his 100% confidant on almost every single thing that he did that first year with the Wild. And, you know, so Tom had a big say in helping make trades like the, or being an advisor for trades like Kevin Fiala and some of these other trades that in hindsight wound up really working out the last couple of years. So, but unfortunately, again, really, especially the last year, he wasn't around every day. He was, you know, getting a lot of treatment, and it's been a tough last year for him, especially the last couple of weeks for him as well. But when he was Paul Fenton's right-hand man, he absolutely, had a huge say in a lot of the moves that Paul did. And really, for those 3 weeks after Paul was let go, he was actually the acting GM of the team until Bill Guerin was hired, and Bill and him hit it off right away. And Bill, I know, has a tremendous amount of respect for him. And I talked to, texted with Bill this morning and actually the last couple of days. And I know that he's, it's been a real tough couple of days for him.
I think he actually passed away this morning, was it? Or was it just announced this morning?
No, he did pass away this morning. Yeah. So he had a final Father's Day with his family.
Yeah.
Yeah, the last week they've done their best to just try to make him comfortable is the way that I understand it. He had a fall last Monday and unfortunately the last week has been just he's been frail and about just keeping him as comfortable as humanly possible.
Yeah, the old, ashes to ashes, dust to dust, you come full circle. But yeah, with my only two real opportunities to spend any time with him, they were just on the air at the state fair doing a quick, 15 minute interview with him, but he seemed like a real gentleman and a great guy. So thanks on short notice for joining us. We'll do it again. Let's try to do it sometime when we're not going to have a death. Let's maybe do it maybe talk hockey of some sort or something of that nature. But again, on short notice, thank you very much. I do appreciate it.
Yeah, anytime, Colin. See ya.
Thanks, you bet. That's Michael Russo of The Athletic. You're on the Common Man program. And Tennessee, did we just, we turned the lights on it?
By the way, Russo is filling in for Paul Allen tomorrow. So
he is?
We'll chat more about that and probably Kirill Kaprizov and everything Wild and NHL related tomorrow.
Well, I saw during five, by the way, are we now doing a digital? What are we doing? Are we putting this on social, this interview?
Yeah, this is on the live. Yeah, this is live on KFN.
Oh,
social.
It was? Yeah. Oh, yeah. I guess I should have promoted that ahead of time. Because the lights are
bright in there.
They're awful bright in here. I'm not used to the red, white, hot spotlight. Speaking of Kaprizov, I don't know if you were going to bring it up in 5-3-4. I saw over the weekend, I saw one of those stories. And I don't know, because I just glanced at it. But it was, and I don't know, because you have websites where, when I say legitimate, I mean people that are employed as sports reporters and get a paycheck.
Yeah.
Then you have those ones that are just
clickbait.
Well, yeah, clickbait. Yeah. Like, you'll have, there's something called fan-sided. Is fan-sided than someone, it's just a website where fans write into it. It's really not, and not that they can't have an opinion.
Sure.
But so I don't know what this one was, but it was basically that, well, Kaprizov's now not exactly sure if he wants to sign here and he might go back over and play in Russia. Well, I don't know if I believe.
That stems from a, Kevin Weeks tweet. Kevin Weeks is a former NHL goalie, does analyst work for NHL Network.
Okay.
And basically he had a tweet, and I'm paraphrasing here, I don't have it in front of me, that Kaprizov is in Moscow. The team he played for in Russia is interested in bringing him back, and that's an option for him. Well, he was in Moscow, as Russo then mentioned, well, because he was going to a buddy's wedding there.
Okay, right.
And, Kevin Weeks' agent is also Kirill Kaprizov's agent. So it's also, all right, well, is this a legit thing where he might go back to, or is it just
posture?
Adrian trying to leverage to the media and put pressure on Bill Guerin and the rest of the staff?
And, you would think it would be the latter, but it could be the former. Young guy, homesick, likes it there. I don't think that'll happen, but let's just say it did. How devastating would that be to the organization, the fan base? You get, this kid, he's going to win. What's the Rookie of the Year called?
The Calder Trophy.
He's going to win it, right? More than likely.
Yes.
He wins that. I mean, he led all rookies in scoring, I believe. I think he...
In goals. Like eighth in the league in goals total.
Yeah, total. Overall. I mean, veterans and everything. To play like that, if all of a sudden he made the announcement, I'm kind of going to just come back and play in
Russia. Yeah, I don't buy it, but...
Well, I'm just saying, I don't buy it either.
They're going to use that for their leverage, yeah.
But if he did, that would be devastating to the organization, to all the fans, and to the Jolly Green Giant himself. Tenabe. Folks, at Casey's General Store brings us 534. What do you got for us, Tennessee?
Should the Wolves acquire the worst shooter in basketball?
KFAN, Total Draft.